afternoon. I want to thank you all for being here today. I consider this to be a very important announcement. This city's been stringing together some pretty nice wins here lately. Recently, we were named as one of only five cities to win a $30 million choice grant from HUD. We recently joined only four other cities in the world to be named to an IEEE Core Smart City, that's Institute of Electronic and Electrical Engineers. We're currently working alongside the Royals and Major League Baseball to build a model urban youth baseball academy at Parade Park. This is a one-of-a-kind project that is devoted to working with the city's urban youth and to attract development and visitors to the 18th and Vine area, which is an historic part of Kansas City. But the reality is simply this. None of these great accomplishments really mean anything if people don't feel safe in this city. And as mayor, I remain disheartened to some extent by the persistent, senseless violence that occurs in our city, whether that violence involves guns or domestic violence or child abuse or potential terrorism. All of those things are negatives and big negatives in my mind. And we don't and cannot expect entrepreneurs to make this their home as willingly if they don't feel safe here. We can't expect businesses to stay here if we can't control violence and if their products and their personnel and employees are at risk. We can't expect families to want to settle in this city or parts of this city if the schools don't function and there's violence in the city and kids that grow up here don't feel safe or that they don't feel educated. And almost every day, we learn of a new school shooting that's taken place someplace around the country. We hear of another child that's been abused or left for dead or shot because of somebody driving by with a high-powered rifle shoots into their home. This past week, our TVs, telephones, computers, smartphones, everything flooded with images of devastation from Paris, a lot of violence that went on there at the hands of terrorists. And as we see these weekly reports of accidental deaths involving firearms, intentional deaths involving firearms, child abuse that leaves families devastated, acts of domestic violence that harms children and parents, either male or female, depending on who the victim and the perpetrators are. All of these things are things that I feel that we need to have citizens of this city take a look at. We know that there's more that we should do and can be done, and we know that there's a need to change the conversation on violence in this country, this state, and in this city. And we know that we need to take some action. So today, I am proud to announce, along with my friend and colleague, Councilwoman Jolie Justice of the 4th District, a Citizens Task Force on Violence. The mission of this task force is multifactorial. First, they're to gather facts, data, and information using subject matter experts that are available to them in the form of the FBI, ATF, the police department, mental health people, domestic violence, all sorts of places and people who deal with violence every day to find out what we can do in a collaborative, cohesive way to present fixes, not just conversation, fixes for some of these problems to the extent that we can in terms of ordinances, legislations, or policies that we can enact. And we want to be pragmatic about it. We want to make sure that we're prepared for active shooter problems, violence-driven street crimes, illegal use of weapons, domestic violence, child abuse, and we want to make sure that we have some idea of what we would be doing and should do in the event we're ever victims of an attack by a terrorist, whether domestic or foreign. So I'm extremely grateful for the folks who have answered this call to come here and be with us today, and others who may be at it at a later date. And I want to thank them for making a commitment to make Kansas City safer. And so with that, I'll turn it over to my friend and the chair of this committee, Councilwoman Jolie Justice of the 4th District.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You know, when the mayor asked me to do this, one of the first things that I said to him is I don't want to be involved in another commission or task force that spends 6 months or a year, puts together a report that sits on a shelf and no action is taken. If we are going to do this, we need to come up with pragmatic solutions that are attainable in the short term and the long term. For the last 8 years, I spent my time in Jefferson City as a Missouri State Senator, and one of the things that we were able to do while we were down there is put together some policy improvements that we have yet to see the benefits of. What we can do here locally is much more significant, because we can take all of the best information that we have on a national, state, and local level and actually come up with pragmatic solutions that will work. We know what the problem is. Every day we turn on our television, we flip on our phone, we open the newspaper, and we see what the problem is. We even know what some of the answers are. We know that we have to look at things like gun safety and health, mental health. We have to look at poverty, education. We have to look at mass incarceration. What we don't have is a constant conversation among citizens on how we can take all of that knowledge and actually put it to work to make our city better. And so that's why I'm excited to be a part of this. I look forward to working with all of these folks here to make sure that we move this issue forward in Kansas City.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Now, another voice from a different angle. Rosalind Temple has been responsible for Mothers in Charge in this city for quite some time. Go ahead, Rosalind.
Good afternoon. My name is Rosalind Temple. In 2011, November 23rd, what was Thanksgiving Eve, my son Antonio Thompson was found murdered in his apartment. He was 26 years old. From that day, it changed my life. Kansas City is my community, where I was born and raised. So I took a stand to make a better and safer place for us to live. So this is why I'm a part of this task force board. I think it's very important that I can come and be a part of walking the pain and grief as a mother every day to stand and support my community and to save someone else's child's life. I couldn't save my child's life, but I guarantee you I can save someone else's life. That's why I'm a part of this board.
Thank you, Rosalind. Now, I'm asking these folks to spend, this very diverse group of citizens, to spend the next year consulting with subject matter experts and others to explore ways to make Kansas City safer. We have to reduce all types of violence so that everyone in this community, whether they're employers or employees, homeowners or renters, school children or parents and adults, will feel safer in this city and at work and at play in this community. So I look forward to learning about their work as they go forward, but more importantly, I look forward to them producing, and I emphasize the word producing, something tangible that we can actually do that's pragmatic and that will make a difference. We are always going to be looking to do something, not just talk it to death. And therefore, we have people from different walks of life we brought together in order to accomplish that. Now, I'll be happy to open it up for questions, but I would like to tell you the names of the people who are on the task force. And I'll start with, and if as I say your name, raise your hand so that they can identify you, if you would. Deidre Anderson, who is the Executive Director of United Inner City Services. Judge Charlie Atwell, former Judge Charlie Atwell, who is an attorney now at Follen Wickens and a former Jackson County Circuit Court judge. Charles Casely, Chuck Casely, the Vice President of Marketing and Public Affairs for KCP&L. Alyssa Kennedy, 5th District Councilwoman. Jose Faust, an artist and writer and educator. Tina Harris, an old friend, pastor, Grand Avenue Temple United Methodist Church. She of the woman with big hair. Jill Katz, an attorney. Jonathan Kemper, vice chair of Commerce Bank Shares. Rodney Knott, the CEO of Reengage Staffing Services. Alan Markley, the superintendent of the Raytown Quality Schools. Nancy Oliveras, an attorney. DJ Pierre, an assistant city prosecutor. Judy Sherry, president and owner of Judy Sherry Consortium Advertising and Marketing. You've met Rosalind Temple. Wick Thomas, teen services librarian, Kansas City Public Library. And Crystal Williams, a Jackson County legislator. And the chair, the vice chair serving in that capacity with Councilwoman Justice is Andres Dominguez, a program officer at the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City. And with that, we'll take questions.
Mayor, when did you begin this?
Oh, there you are.
Betsy Webster, KCTV. 65, this is a two-part question, which I know those are terrible, but I want to squeeze it in. When did you begin the process of selecting folks for this task force, and what was the tipping point that made you feel that this was necessary?
Well, actually, I started thinking about the task force shortly before we took office for the second term in August. Got distracted by the things that we needed to do in order just to get everybody acclimated to the council, and then started having conversations with Councilwoman Justice, what, a couple months ago? A couple months ago on that, and then we started throwing names around, ideas around, concepts around 2 months ago.
And so what was it that made you feel that this was necessary? Why now? Why this, and why the people you've selected?
Well, the people we selected are going to be there for different reasons. They represent some constituency or some thought pattern, or in some instances, they just said, this happened to me, this is a situation that occurred, I want to be part of this, or I want to be part of something like this, and we took that into account. Those were the things. And why now? Because it was just a natural evolution for me. I think probably the last major thing that really tipped me over the edge was the shooting of the three people out on the east side, including an infant. And, you know, I can't just continue to talk about it. I felt the need that we needed to do something. And I felt that there was a need not just for me to do something, but for actual citizens, not people in bureaucratic spaces or governmental places, but actual citizens to look at this issue in a cohesive, comprehensive way and move forward with some idea of what's going on, because frankly, we need to educate ourselves, but we need to educate the citizens with whom we deal every day as well.
Mayor, Joe Arce, Kansas City Hispanic News.
Yeah.
Hi, Joe. How do families benefit from this in terms of those that have been victimized by drive-by shootings and have lost loved ones? Because I know we talked a little bit about mental health, but so often these families do go to mental health facilities and there's not enough dollars there for them. And a lot of them are suffering by themselves. So how will that help these families?
Well, I don't know, Joe, because they haven't, our group hasn't done anything yet. That's one of the things that they are going to be charged with doing, is how do we address those types of issues. I know the situation as it currently exists is not acceptable. What we're looking for are ways to make it more acceptable. And that's going to be impossible until they've had time to look at the options, find out where there are possibilities for improvements and change, and we have an opportunity to find a way to do that. But it's not going to bring anybody back. That's never going to happen. It's too late for people like Rosalyn, who lost her son, but the idea is that you take that loss and you turn it into something positive and you try to drive some sort of a positive solution. That's what this is. This is a way of looking forward on what we can do and what we can do to change existing practices in a way that may be more beneficial to people who do suffer in the future.
You have KC Nova. How do you see this complementing or supplementing what Nova does?
You have to remember what KC Nova is. KC Nova is a focused deterrence model. It very specifically and very directly identifies people who are engaged in the most violent acts in the city, and they're in groups. And then KC Nova comes in to stop and interdict that group violence. KC Nova in that space is working quite well. We're about a couple of murders higher this year than we were last year on the group violence. Where we've seen a spike is in things that KC Nova have really nothing to do with. Domestic violence deaths are up. Child abuse deaths are up. KC Nova doesn't do that. They can't be there. It's not a group activity where we say that because something happened to Mrs. Jones last week, Mr. Jones, and being in a group, is going to come home, sit across a table, have a couple of beers, get into an argument, pull out a gun, and blow her away. KC Nova doesn't address that. We're trying to be an adjunct to all of the existing programs. Nova will be a subject matter expert for us. They will be partners with us as we find ways where we can intersect. I know that we have an interest in Nova of what can we do about domestic violence. Is that a space for us? But it gets outside of the focused deterrence model. And with a program like Nova, where we have partners brought together very specifically to bring things to the table for that model, we have to be focused on that. What we're looking at is everything else, including that.
Does this group have a budget?
No, it doesn't, but we'll have to find some money somewhere. I was thinking that we could go to the television stations and borrow a little cash.
And what is your number one expectation from this group?
My number one expectation from this group is that a group of Kansas City, Missouri citizens will learn about violence in the city, and they will come back and tell us some things that we can do to lower the rate of violence in the city. That's my number one expectation.
Is there a time frame, ma'am?
One year.
Is this committee going to serve a year or two or three?
One year. One year.
Sorry?
One year.
One year?
Yeah, one year.
Are you seeing some type of results or some tangible something to help?
I'm sorry, say that again.
When can we start seeing, I know the committee is going to be 1 year, but when can we start seeing some results or something in place?
1 year.
1 year.
Okay. Well, they'll come back in a year with recommendations, and then it's not going to be a matter of flipping a switch and doing things. We'll have to do, put it, whatever processes are in place. We'll have to go to Jefferson City and argue for whatever legislation. We'll have to introduce whatever ordinances or policy changes in city government that are necessary. But the baseline point will be 1 year from now, or maybe they come back and say, hey, look, we need more time. We've gotten too deep into this. I don't know. But 1 year is what we're starting for. And at the end of that, we'll have a better sense of what we can do and how long it'll take to do specific things. Yes, Lynn?
Mayor, we have had a lot of these task forces. Yeah. I have heard other task forces say, we intend to come out with something that will not just sit on a shelf. And here we are with another group that wants to write something that won't just sit on a shelf. How is this going to be different from the task force? We've had an existing task force going on for quite a while.
Well, all I can tell you is you ought to look at the task forces I've appointed. And that includes the Citizens Commission on Municipal Revenue that worked for about a year and came back with recommendations, and we've implemented most of those recommendations, and we're still using those recommendations today. I talk about the things that they found out every time I go out and talk about the earnings tax. The groups that I have appointed have come back with solid, doable things, and we then do them. Now, I don't know what somebody else did. I don't know what somebody else's expectations were, and I don't care whether or not they created a report. Like I said, I emphasize the words on production, and that's exactly what I expect here. That's why Jolie Justice is the chair, because of her work at the Missouri House, her work with modernizing the criminal code down there, which I think was very important and a very relevant factor in my selection. You want to say anything about this?
Well, I mean, for 8 years, I stood in Jefferson City and argued against legislation that I thought was harmful for Kansas City, and I tried to explain why one size does not fit all for the state. That Kansas City, that St. Louis, that Springfield, Columbia, we face issues that frankly are different than issues that are faced in rural Missouri. And so one of the things that I wanted to make sure we did was put together a group of people who are going to look specifically at Kansas City's problems and come up with policies that we can implement either locally with the help of our, we've got right with us today, the chair of Neighborhoods and Public Safety. A former prosecutor and a form of Councilwoman Alicia Kennedy, who is incredibly passionate about this issue. She's serving on the committee with us. We are going to come up with ideas that we will either be able to implement here locally, or we will be able to take evidence-based facts to Jefferson City and make our case for why we need to have change there. We know there are lots of things we don't have control over. Funding for mental health, we get it. That's a tough issue to crack. Gun safety, we understand the political state of where we are. That does not mean that we can't come up with incremental changes that will make a difference. And if it makes the difference for one family, then this was a success. I believe this will be successful for the entire community.
I got two questions, please.
You only get one, Eric.
It's a two-part question. Councilwoman Justice, you said at the beginning of this that there's a problem and we know what the problem is. What do you see the problem as? That's question number one. Number two, in 2005, they came up with a commission because we went through the records. This is the eighth crime commission in my 12 years of being at the call, the eighth one. You got a book this thick. Great ideas, great things, never implemented. So what's gonna make people buy into, you're gonna do something that no other one of these commissions has done? But my question to you, what's the problem?
Well, the problem is violence. The problem is that we have people killing their children. We have people killing their intimate partners. We have people killing folks through their car windows as they drive through neighborhoods. I mean, that's the problem, is the violence.
That's a symptom of a problem. That's another problem. That's a symptom.
And that's why I suggested that we understood what was leading to that. That we know we have issues relating to poverty, education, we have issues relating to health care, mass incarceration. All of those are part of it. And I understand that. And you know why this one's going to be different? Because, first of all, the mayor has tasked me with this. And when someone gives me an intractable problem, I don't let go until it gets done. You know, someone came to me 3 years ago and said, we need to completely rewrite the criminal code. We need to start getting tough on crime, not just tough on crime, but smart on crime. And it hasn't been done since the 70s. And you know what? It took us 3 years, but we got it done. These are things that we can accomplish if we put our minds to it. And we're going to do that. And that's how we're going to get it done. That's how this one's going to be different, because you have this group of people here in front of you.
Mr. Mayor, and the other thing is, I'm not a person who sits around, sees a problem, and says, well, somebody tried this in 2005 and didn't do anything, so there's no sense in making an effort. It is not my job to sit here and watch my city go through violent upheavals and do nothing. And do nothing. And if there's one thing that I can guarantee you will be accomplished, is the citizens of this city, by the time this commission, this task force is done, will know a hell of a lot more about the violence in this city than they do now. Step number one is educating people, because there's a lot of people who see it differently than the reality. They think it only happens over here. And they thought that until somebody wound up dead at 57th and Oak the other night, or until somebody got abducted over at Brookside at an ATM. I don't believe that just because it's difficult, we ought to say somebody tried it 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago and back away. Ain't my style, never gonna be my style. It's a problem, it's part of my city, it's a huge issue. We're gonna tackle it. And if we miss this tackle, we'll try a different tackle. And if we miss that one, we'll try a different one. But we're gonna continue to work on bringing the violence level down in this city. And I'm gonna always trust people like Jolie and Alicia and Robin and Rosalind and everybody else up here to focus on that. That's why we have citizens task forces, so that they can do the type of work that only citizens can do. So we're going to do it, and it's going to produce something, and it's going to be something that we're going to implement, come hook or come crook.
Can I get one follow-up?
Yes, sir.
3 years ago, we all met over at the health department. We had a task force, a crime task force. We sat over at the health department for 8 weeks, and we went through program after program. What out of that was implemented, and how come that didn't work? Because that was a great task force that you put together there.
Well, actually, I didn't put that task force together, but thank you anyhow. somebody else did. And what was implemented out of that was the CHIPS program, or the Community Health Improvement Program came out of that. And that is being implemented. As a matter of fact, parts of that were part of our discussion at business session before council a few weeks back, and we saw the incremental improvements. But that's attacking the root problems, and that's where it's supposed to be. I want to attack the symptom and say, if we can't eradicate poverty and poor education, can we find a way to get guns out of the hands of people who shouldn't use them? If we can't eradicate all the things that make people angry, can we find a way to make sure that the person who abuses somebody in the first instance doesn't do it twice or three times? Are there things that we can do here? And there are things that we can do, because I know of programs that are in other places that seem to be working. We can import some of those things here. But the bottom line is, that's what this commission is supposed to do. Look at all the facts, data, programming, best practices, bring it home, see what we can do here to implement and bring the level of violence in the city down. That's my job.
Yep. We're here at the police department. You talked about this being a citizen task force, but is there a partnership with the police? Are they, all the education you talk about, are they going to have access to the crimes task force? Going on.
Absolutely. The police department and Daryl Forte, the chief, sit next to him in NOVA board meetings, and prosecutor sit next to her, ATF, FBI, meet with mental health people. Yeah, we've been in touch to make sure that they are willing to join with us and lend us their subject matter expertise and be partners with us, because they too have a direct role in trying to bring violence down and want to bring it down. But one thing that we know from NOVA works because we brought different groups together with a cohesive function, very clear lines of authority and responsibility, but working together, and the results have been good. We're going to try to do the same thing on a broader scale.
What's going to be the first thing you guys do?
That's going to be up to the chair and the vice chair and to figure out.
Well, I mean, obviously, first we're going to sit down and come up with we're going to discuss the mission, the charge. We're going to put together our goals and our deadlines, and we're going to get moving forward. But one of the first things that we have to do as part of that is we have to learn. So if there have been previous commissions, if there are things that exist that we're not utilizing now, we need to know all of that. All of that information will come to us first, then we'll put together an action plan.
Yeah, what you need?
Yeah, I'm a common citizen.
Yeah.
I want an opportunity to speak. I want to know if you've considered what other cities have done with this same problem. In Chicago, they noted when they took out all of the major players that were criminals, there was a phenomenon that occurred, whereas these young guys who had no training came in and took over those spots. They didn't have training in use of guns, so they're firing for effect. And they found that problem in Chicago. In addition, there was a National Geographic thing called rogue elephants. And what they found was that they killed off all the senior male elephants above 25 years old. And 5 years later, they started noticing that other animals were being beaten and battered and destroyed. What they found out was that these young males who did not have male elephants, that did not have mentoring or training, went into a defense mode and a survival mode. And that's what I believe our children are doing now. That's what they're doing in Chicago and Philadelphia and Los Angeles and some of the other larger cities. So my question is, have you considered what they view, those larger cities have viewed, and what they plan to do about it, such as mentoring programs?
That's what this group is doing. That's what it's supposed to do. They haven't met yet, so they haven't considered much of anything in that regard. But I'm aware of the phenomena, and one thing that we all know is it's that nature abhors a vacuum. So if you take out one part of an organism, it creates a vacuum and something comes in to fill it. We're aware of that. We see that with NOVA. And we have programs in place with NOVA, like TNT, where we have the teens in transition. And we go out and we get the teens in transition who are the most likely to be in a problem and get them working during the summer. We've had pretty good success with that. We have MBK, My Brother's Keeper programs. We have our summer programming. We know for a fact that when kids are doing something in our summer programming, that juvenile crime and juvenile victimization is down between 16 and 18%. We know these things. But we need to pull all of this together. We need to pull things that are being done elsewhere and look at them and see how we can improve what we're doing, do things that we're not doing, and examine things and put those processes in place. I was at the High Aspirations dinner last night. That's an organization of mentors and is growing every year because more and more people are heeding the call. So yeah, I understand what you're talking about, but that's exactly what these folks are supposed to do, is to look at those things and say, yeah, we looked at that, doesn't work. We looked at that, doesn't work well. We looked at this is worth doing. This is an ordinance that we might need. This is a law that we ought to put into place.
And why I ask, because, you know, Chief Forte kind of patted himself on the back last year about the reduction in murders, but this year is going back up. The year before it was about 120, and it dropped to 80. Now we're already at 90.
But it's not going back up because of NOVA. NOVA's task is about the same. It's going up because of domestic violence and child abuse. Those are the two main areas of increase. Although the regular murders are going up, NOVA deals with interdicting group-related behaviors. If it's not group-related, it's not something that NOVA deals with. The non-group-related stuff is what is up. The group-related stuff is about the same, a little bit higher, but not much off of where it was. So we need to make sure that we're defining what we're talking about. I look at it very simply. The numbers are up, and people are dying. And it doesn't matter whether it's 120, 15, 110, 90, or 80. People are dying. What I want to know is, are we doing everything that we can to stop them from dying? And that's the task of this group of people here, to find that out and to tell us, no, we're not. Here's what we need to do, and here's how we ought to do it. That's what they're here for.
Finally, if I can.
This is it. Last question.
Yes, sir. Are you considering job training programs? Give these young individuals something to do and a direction to go?
We've considered job training programs in different contexts, but again, this group hasn't even met yet, and until they meet, they're not going to have an idea of what they should and shouldn't do. Let them get their handle on the issues and go forward, and then let's hear what they come back with. Right now, they haven't considered anything, but I can tell you, I've got a group that's been working on job programs for youth for the last year, and their recommendations will be coming out so that we can hire more youth this summer. And we're in the process of doing that. So we're trying to work on as many levels as we can, but this group has a very specific purpose. Why are we killing? Can we stop it? What do we need to do, and how? That's what they're going to tell us, or at least hope they're going to tell us.
And Mayor, it sounds like the data is still, I mean, obviously they're going to be looking at the data, so some of that micro data is not available yet, but you did say the numbers are up. Are you talking about violent deaths? Are you talking about violence, period? When you say the numbers are up, what number are you referring to?
Homicides are up, and so are aggravated assaults.
That's all I wanted to check that. And then lastly, when you mentioned how NOVA has been successful, but it has a limited realm that it is focused on with group-related things, is that also the case with groups like Ad Hoc, Aim for Peace, Combat?
No. They're different programs.
Are they all successful, yet you're realizing something's missing? Is that kind of where this... programs in place, but yet
they're different programs and they have a different mission. KC NOVA is a focused deterrence program that is a very specific definition and a very specific approach, and that's what they do. Ad Hoc Against Crime does a lot of different things. They interact with victims, they get tips, they talk to the police, they have vigils, they get involved in civic things, etc., etc. Aim for Peace does really a totally different thing, and that's really on the street mediation of more acute things. Something flares up, and Aim for Peace is there to calm it down and stop it from blowing up. If Aim for Peace wasn't doing what they were doing, the numbers would be higher. If Ad Hoc wasn't doing what it was doing, the numbers would be higher still. If NOVA wasn't doing what it's doing, the numbers would still be higher.
When you were talking about NOVA, you were saying that there were certain categories that they really don't address based on their focus, and it would seem that Aim for Peace and some of these other groups are in that same sense, in that they don't necessarily address the child abuse cases,
no,
the domestic violence cases. Those are the two categories you mentioned that aren't addressed by some of these groups that we hear about on a high-profile level that have been working in Kansas City to deter violence for several years.
Okay.
Is that my understanding that accurately?
It is not their mission to address domestic violence or child abuse as a core mission. As a overall approach, yeah, they do. We all do as an overall approach. But what are we missing when we know that domestic violence numbers are increasing? What do we do to stop that? What do we do to bring it down? There's nobody really focused on that in a very focused and concentrated way. Those are the things that I'm talking about. How do we bring the overall level of violence down, regardless of what kind of violence it is? Violence is violence, and it has a negative impact on the people who perpetrate it and the people who are victimized by it. All right, we're done. Thank you.
Thank you all, ladies and gentlemen. I have a news.